This is just to give you a rough idea of the kinds of situations that we can discuss. This is a really schematic picture, and also a pretty fake picture. I'll tell you how it's fake in a big way in just a second. This is the heart. Circulatory system. Heart pumps blood around. The heart is a pump. The heart adds energy to the blood. It does work. It grabs the blood and it pushes it through your veins. That's what the heart does. It does it in a fancy way. It does it by having a valve on this side that doesn't open and a valve on this side that does, and it flexes and it shoots a bunch of liquid out. But it's basically pushing the blood through your circulatory system. That's what pumps do. They push fluids. So I'm going to have a blower right here that's going to push air. Pumps push fluid. So on one end, this side right here where the blood comes out, the pressure is going to be higher because the blood, just generally, because that's what a pump tries to do. It tries to push it. Not just tries, there's a space here. It pushes blood this way and around. And the way I've drawn it, it's a clockwise motion through the arteries, through capillaries, and back to the vein. The thing that's ridiculous about this is that I only drew one capillary. And not only do you not just have one capillary per artery, you have so many of these capillaries that the total size of the capillaries is actually bigger than the arteries or the veins. So the capillaries are actually, because you have so many of them, each of them is tiny, but because you have so many of them, the total size of them is bigger than anything else, turns out. So this is a ridiculous picture, but it at least gives me a way of talking about how fluids can be treated in this kind of a problem. And the way I'm going to talk about it is to think about a piece of the fluid. First of all, I should say, and I'll say more than once probably, every time we draw a set of pipes, I'm going to call, since this is a pump, I'm going to call these pipes. This is an artery. The capillary is a tiny little pipe. The vein is another pipe that comes back. I'm just going to call those pipes right now because we're going to have water flowing through pipes, air flowing through pipes, and so I'm going to call these pipes also. You probably know that your circulatory system is completely full of blood. There aren't a lot of gaps and spaces and air pockets that are floating around. It's basically full of blood. That is going to be the way for every pipe you see. You should assume right at the beginning that it's a piece. This section right here is a piece of a larger system. This section right here is a piece of the bottom. You're just seeing part of it, but the whole thing is filled with blood. There's blood behind this little volume that I called V sub I, the initial volume. There's blood behind there. What's that blood doing? It's pushing on it because something pushed on it. So it's pushing on this. And there's also fluid on the other side. The pipes are completely full. So this little piece right here is being pushed on from behind, and it's pushing the stuff that's ahead of it. Those two things are going on at the same time. If it's being pushed on from behind, you in physics 7a, if we identify all the molecules that are painted red there as our physical system, then its energy can go up or down. Why would it go up? Well, if we transferred energy into it, why would it go down if we transferred energy out? This blood right behind it is pushing on it, so it's doing work on that system. It's transferring energy to this fluid identified as the volume right there, the red molecules. And because it's transferring energy into those red molecules, those red molecules are pushing on the stuff on the other side. So they're doing work on the other side. So they're transferring work energy out. So as you go through this capillary, some work energy gets transferred in, some work energy gets transferred out, and we'll have to add those two together to find the total amount of energy change. I left out Q because, well, we're not going to worry about heat transfers in this kind of a problem. They may be there, they're probably small. Steady state is the word that we're going to use for what goes on here. Steady state means the things that you see are not changing. The velocity of the fluid at any point is constant. Whatever it happens to be, it's constant. Maybe it's faster or slower somewhere else. But whatever it is, it's not changing with time. Steady state means things are not changing with time. And so that's the situation we're going to be in. When you first start up your blood flow, there may be changes with time for a little bit, but eventually it settles down into a steady state. So when you do that calculation, there's fluid, there's work because the fluid's being pushed on. There's work because the fluid is pushing on other things. So there's a total energy transfer, and that just is a pressure times volume kind of work that you already know something about. An important point for water and blood and essentially all liquids almost all liquids that we care about, they are incompressible. In 7A, you took a little syringe, you pulled some water into it, and you tried to compress it, and you find out the water can't be compressed, or hardly at all. Whereas when you filled the syringe with gas, you could compress it really easily. Gases are compressible. Liquids are not. And so I'm presuming this is a liquid, and I'm going to say V final equals V initial. As it got pushed through there, it didn't change its volume. It just got pushed. So work energy was transferred in, and that depends on the pressure change. I considered that energy transfer to be thermal energy. Any reason you can see from this picture why I might not have included gravitational potential energy in going from here over to the, from the right to the left? Yeah, the height's the same. You know that that's not always true for liquids. Liquids flow downhill. So the height can change. And those height changes will give you gravitational potential energy changes. I left that out here, but we'll have to add it back in. Another thing I left out is kinetic energy changes. And we will talk about those. But in the end, we're going to have them in there. We're going to have thermal energy changes. We're going to have kinetic energy changes. We're going to have gravitational potential energy changes. And you're going to have to think about all of those. And we also have, by this calculation back here, V times delta P, we have changes in pressure from one location to another. These are the energy systems that you have to worry about. What does a pump do? A pump puts energy in or takes it out. You connect a pump up to the wall, and energy gets, you buy energy from PG&E, and then you put it into the fluid system. That's what the pump does. Or you eat your breakfast in the morning, and ATP, ADP, a lot of stuff happens, and then your heart muscles put energy in, and it gets it that way. One way or another, the energy has to come from something when you use a pump. Well, I already told you that the volume, we're going to use incompressible fluid, so these volumes are always going to be the same. And so I'm going to divide both sides by the volume. And then then when you divide something by the volume, you're talking about energy per unit volume, and we call that energy density. Density means per unit volume or per unit size of something. And so this is an energy density. Pressure itself is an energy per unit volume. Kinetic energy we divide by the volume. Gravitational potential we divide by the volume. Thermal energy divide by the volume. By the way, I also put thermal energy over here on the right. So it's got a minus sign all of a sudden because I subtracted it from both sides. In fact, maybe I'll just write this down right now. Our model, the first part of our model, has changes in pressure. That's a change in kinetic energy. Kinetic energy density. Kinetic energy, remember, is 1/2 times the speed squared. This is 1/2 times the Greek letter rho is, sorry, kinetic energy is 1/2 the mass times the speed squared. This is 1/2 the mass per unit volume times the speed squared. Mass per unit volume is rho, the Greek letter rho. So this right here is mass per unit volume. And what changes is the speed in a flow problem. The mass per unit volume is not going to change because the fluid's incompressible. We're not going to change the amount of stuff in any volume. Gravitational potential energy, mgh. So changes in that, mg delta h. So I'm going to write rho g delta h. Rho is, again, mass per unit volume. So gravitational potential energy per unit volume can be written that way. If you have a pump, you can put energy in, energy density per unit, or sorry, energy per unit volume. And I'm going to do one more thing. I'm going to give you an equation for E thermal per unit volume. And it's the current times the resistance of the pipe. The current is the amount of stuff flowing past any point per unit time, and the amount of fluid, we measure fluid by volume, so the amount would be cubic meters per second. So the units of current for fluid flow is cubic meters per second. That's the volume that that flows past any point per second. That's a piece of the model that we're working with. I'm going to write, no, I won't do it yet. So this is a question for you. Suppose you dive into a swimming pool and swim 3 meters down, so 10 feet down. Or you drop 3,000 meters from a high mountain down into a valley, so 10,000 feet. Hopefully you'd do that with a parachute, but anyway. What changes? If I just pick something like PV equals NRT, I pick a bunch of things. What's the physical thing that changes when you do something like that? What do you notice?